express in newton and distance we are going to express in terms of meter. So product of newton meter is joule. Okay, and in thermodynamics how we are going to define the work? So in case of thermodynamics we are going to define the work as work is done by a system. If the sole effect on the things external to the system can be reduced to the rising of a weight. Okay, so we explained with the help of the pulley and stirrer arrangement. Okay. So in case of thermodynamics the work is said to be done by a system on the surroundings if the sole effect on the things external to the system could have been done by rising of another weight. Okay, so that's initially we are having this position. So okay, when is work done by the system on the surroundings? So it helps to lowering of a weight. Okay, so means starting we are having some position. Okay, so after work done by the system, so that there will be the fall in the weight. Okay, the weight moves down to a small distance. Whatever the initial weight position and final weight position, that gives the distance moved by the object. How we are going to take the displacement in case of mechanics like that, here we are going to explain in terms of thermodynamic properties. Okay, so I'll explain once again. So this is the closed container having certain quantity of the fluid enclosed inside the system, and stirrer we are having, it is attached to a pulley, and the weight arrangement as shown in the figure. Okay, so and we are having a thermometer to know the initial and final temperature. Okay, starting we are having, just you consider it as a system, we are having the fluid at initial point P1, we are having the properties P1, V1 and T1, so that when the pulley moves, okay, so there will be falling of the weight. Actually how the fall of the weight takes place? Due to change in the thermodynamic properties which is external to the system, which helps to lower a weight. Okay, so that we can define the thermodynamics definition of work as, the work is said to be done by system. This we are going to consider it as system. The work is done by a system if the sole effect on the things, means whatever starting we are having P1, V1, T1, as the pulley moves down, so there will be the fall in the weight. Okay, actually how this fall of the weight takes place? Due to change in the thermodynamic properties of the system, which is external to the system. Okay, hence we can define thermodynamics definition of work as, the work is said to be done by a system if the sole effect on the things external to the system can be helps to lower a weight. Okay, so this is how we are going to define the thermodynamics definition of work. After that we discussed the PDV work. Okay, so with the help of a piston and cylinder arrangement, starting we are having this point one. Okay, and initially we are having the fluid at the properties P1, V1 and T1, it is bounded by a piston. As I said, according to the Pascal's law, okay, the fluid exerts pressure equally on in all the directions. So as there is an upward force, that is this piston moves in the forward direction. So then after some times, okay, it reaches the final state 2. Okay, and then once again that state 2 is in equilibrium condition, represented by properties P2, V2 and T2. Okay, then how we are going to explain the PDV work is that, okay, so I am going to take one intermediate point. Okay, any point you can take in between 1 and 2. Okay, and then the distance moved by the piston is ds. Okay, we can say it as dx. Okay, we derived the derivation by taking the equation. Okay, as I said, dW is the work done by the piston. It is given by the force into displacement. How we are going to explain the mechanics definition of the same thing, we are going to explain in terms of thermodynamics also. dW is a small amount of the work done. It's not entire work. So this is the work done by the system from position 1 to intermediate state. You remember, this is not entire path of the process. That is dW equals to F into dL. Okay. So we know that F is the force acting into dL is our the small displacement from initial position 1 to, you remember, this is the diagram you have to analyze properly. So this is the point 1, and so I'm going to take an intermediate point, and dx is the distance traveled by the piston from point 1 to intermediate point. Okay. And we know that the force is product of pressure and area, because we know that pressure equals to force divided by area, that is Newton per meter square. So hence force equals to the pressure into area. So we are going to substitute the value of F as P into A into dL. Okay, just you have to take the simple equation. The force is nothing but pressure into area into dL. Okay, and dW equals to, once again, the product of A into dL, that is the area into the change in distance, is given by our volume, because A is in meter square and dL is in meter. So the product of meter square and meter is meter cube. So the unit of volume is meter cube. So you have to replace the product of A and dL as dV. So dW equals to P into dV. So this is the amount of work done by the piston as it moves from initial position 1 to intermediate point, you remember. So where dV is small amount of displacement volume. But our aim is to find out what is the amount of the work done for the entire process path between 1 to 2. We found out only the work done during the change in position from 1 to intermediate point. In order to find out the entire work between the state points 1 and 2, is you have to integrate this equation between the limits 1 to 2, where 1 and 2 are the state points. So that dW is, you have to integrate W 1 to 2 equals to integration of dW, that is integration of PdV. Okay, you remember dW equals to P into dV is the amount of work done from 1 to intermediate point. In order to find out the total amount of the work done from point 1 to point 2 is, we have to integrate this equation between the limits. So, and we are going to represent W 1 to 2 as integration of PdV. So you have to remember, this is the standard equation used for the derivation of work done for various process, like constant volume process, constant pressure process, constant temperature process, adiabatic process, and polytropic process. This is the one standard equation you should remember. And based upon that one, we have discussed point function and path function. So every time they used to ask, differentiate between point function and path function. Okay. So point function, you see, state 1, all the properties have definite values. These are called as point functions. Thermodynamic properties are the example of point function. For example, we are having a definite value of P1, V1, T1 at state point 1. We are having the definite values of P2, V2 and T2 at state point 2. So these are called as point functions. Point functions are nothing but they are having the definite values at particular state point. Examples, pressure, volume and temperature. On the other hand, path function is one which does not depend upon the end states, rather than it depends upon the entire the process path followed between the starting and end state points. You see, the work done, it does not depend upon one, or it does not depend upon the two, but on the other end, it depends on the entire state points passed through between 1 and 2. Hence, work done is, it does not depend upon the state points, rather than it depends upon the entire path followed. Okay. And second difference is that, so the, all the thermodynamic properties are point functions. The work done, heat transfer, these are all path functions. Okay. Next, third difference is that the point functions, that is, suppose if you are going to take integration of dV between the state point 1 and 2, how we are going to write? V2 minus V1. Similarly, integration of dV between the state points 1 and 2 is P2 minus P1. Suppose if I am going to find out integration of dT, that we are going to write T2 minus T1. So that there we can tell it as they are the definite integrals. On the other hand, suppose if you are writing integration of W1 to 2, okay, as we got the equation, and suppose if I am going to integrate integration of W2, you cannot write W2 minus W1, because the W2 minus W1 is not dependent upon the end state points, rather than it depends upon the entire path followed. Okay, hence the point functions have definite values and they are definite integrals. On the other hand, the path functions like work done, heat transfer, I'll explain the heat transfer in the next slides. Okay, even heat transfer is also a path function. They are inexact differential, because suppose we integrate integration of W1 to 2, we cannot write W2 minus W1, rather than we have to write like this only, W1 to 2. What is 1 to 2? So work done during the entire path followed between the state points 1 and 2. Always we have to represent W1 to 2 like this. Similarly, heat transfer also, we are going to represent the heat transfer as Q1 to 2. So all the path functions are represented by W1 to 2, Q1 to 2, etc. In thermodynamics, mainly we are going to deal with two path functions. One is work done and second one is the heat transfer. Okay, remember, it's the most important concept, differentiate between point functions and path function. You have to write 4 to 5 differences between point functions and path functions. Next concept, we studied okay, so how to derive the derivation. Okay, so first one is constant pressure process. Okay, as I said here, I'll repeat once again, already I explained. Okay, just for your sake of things, you have to understand once again, because these are the most important derivation. Okay, every time they used to ask this derivation only, derive expression for work done in various process. Okay, and meantime you should remember the PV diagram also. PV diagram is not there here, but you have to remember the PV diagram. So first process is constant pressure process. It is also called as isobaric process. Here the process remains constant. Okay, so now how we are going to represent isobaric process means you have to represent the horizontal state line in the PV diagram, because the pressure remains constant. On the other hand, volume varies. You remember the nature of curve in PV diagram is the horizontal straight line. Okay. Next step is, first always you have to write the PV diagram. Okay. First you have to draw the PV diagram, then only you have to do the derivation. Okay. And as I say, for all the derivation, you have to remember integration of PdV for all the process, whatever it is, isobaric, isothermal or isochoric, whatever it is. First step is you have to write the standard equation, that is PdV work or displacement work. Okay. W1 to 2 equals to integration of PdV. Okay. So in case of a constant pressure process, so P is constant, you have to integrate dV between the limits V1 to V2. Okay. You see, so in case of constant pressure process, you have to take the term P outside and integration of dV between the limits V1 to V2. So you put P as it is, integration of dV between the limits V1 to V2 is V2 minus V1. And unit of work done is Newton meter, that is product of force and displacement, force in Newton and displacement in meter. So product of a Newton meter is joules. Okay. So unit of work done is joule. And the standard equation for work done during a constant pressure process is T into V2 minus V1. Okay. Are you following, guys? Any doubts? Okay.
No, sir.
Okay. Good. Next, you remember the process name. First, I am telling there are hardly five processes. Okay. You have to remember the different names for each process. Constant pressure process or isobaric process. Bar means unit of pressure. And second one is constant volume process. The another name for constant volume process is isochoric process. And before doing the derivation, you have to draw the PV diagram. The nature of curve in constant volume process is vertical line because the volume remains same. So V is in X coordinate and P is in Y coordinate. So constant volume process is represented by vertical straight line in PV diagram. Okay. In constant volume process, the pressure changes from P1 to P2 and V1 equals to V2 because the volume remains same. And then next step is you have to write the standard equation. As I said, W1 to 2 equals to integration of PdV for whatever process it is. First, you have to write the standard equation. This is the equation for PdV work or displacement work, what we discussed now. Okay? So next, what is the value? P into integration of dV. dV is what? V2 minus V1. It is exactly zero. You remember during isochoric process, there is no work done at all. Work done is equals to zero in case of constant volume process. This is the second process. Okay. And third one, isothermal process or constant temperature process. Okay. And the nature of curve, as we studied in the previous class, is it is the parabolic curve between the points 192. And equation is PV equals to constant. You remember the equation for isothermal process is PV equals to constant. How we are getting PV equals to constant? We are having the ideal gas equation PV equals to MRT, where M is mass of the gas, that is a constant term. R is general gas constant, that is also constant term, and T, temperature, is constant in case of isothermal process. So the entire term MRT is represented by another symbol known as C. So PV equals to constant in case of isothermal process. You should remember the equation for isothermal process, PV equals to constant. So before that, first you have to draw the PV diagram showing the parabolic curve. 1 to 2, and you have to write the equation as PV equals to C. Next step is you have to write the work done during displacement work. W1 to 2 equals to integration of PdV, where 1 and 2 are the state points, P is pressure, and dV is the displacement volume. That is what we studied, A into dL. Okay. Next, you have to write the equation for isothermal process. Equation for isothermal process is PV equals to constant. Suppose if you are taking between the two state points, I can write P1 V1 equals to P2 V2 equals to constant. That is also correct. So what PV equals to constant is the general equation. Suppose if you are taking the process between the two state points 1 and 2, I can write P1 V1 equals to P2 V2 equals to constant. Okay. So from this equation, I can write PV equals to P1 V1 equals to P2 V2 equals to constant. From this one, I am going to find out the value of P. The value of P is P1 V1 divided by V. Okay, just you rearrange the term. P equals to P1 V1 divided by V. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to substitute the value of P1 V1 on this equation in equation number 1. Okay? So here P is nothing but P1 V1 divided by V. Substituting the value of P from, you call it as equation number 2, and you substitute that value of P from equation number 2 in equation number 1. Okay? So, so substitute the value of P as P1 V1 divided by V in limits 1 to 2, okay, into dV, right, as it is. Now, P1 V1 is constant because according to our equation, P1 V1 equals to constant. So you have to take P1 V1 outside. And in the integration part, we are having dV by V. Already you know the integration of 1 by V dV is ln V2 by V1. Okay, you studied in the integration. So P1 V1 integral of 1 by V dV is nothing but ln V2 by V1. Okay, so always you have to take natural logarithm. Okay, suppose they ask problematic, so you have to take natural logarithm. You are having two options in your calculator. One is natural logarithm and another one is your log to the base 10. So don't use log to the base 10. Suppose if you use log to the base 10, you'll get the wrong answer. Always you have to go for natural logarithm, and it is represented by either ln or log to the base e. Okay. So p1 v1 ln v2 by v1. Now I want to express, suppose I want to express the ratio v2 by v1 in terms of p1 and p2 is, we know that p1 v1 equals to p2 v2. So v2 by v1 is nothing but what? P1 by p2. P1 by p2. Just you substitute that value. So w1 to 2 equals to p1 v1 ln p1 by p2. That is also correct. And suppose I can write p2 v2 also. In place of p1 v1, you can write p2 v2, because according to our equation, p1 v1 equals to p2 v2. In place of p1 v1, you can write p2 v2 also. So w1 to 2 is p2 v2 ln v2 by v1, or p2 v2 ln p1 by p2. So either we are having four equations for this isothermal process. First equation is p1 v1 ln v2 by v1. Second equation is p1 v1 ln p1 by p2. Third equation is p2 v2 ln v2 by v1. And fourth equation is p2 v2 ln p1 by p2. Like that you have to remember this equation. So this is the work done during isothermal process or constant temperature process. Yeah. And next important process what I discussed is our adiabatic process. Okay, this is one of the important derivation to find out the work done in adiabatic process. Before that, you should know what is the adiabatic process. Adiabatic process is the process in which there is no heat transfer between system and surroundings. There is no heat interaction between system and surroundings. The value of Q will be zero in case of adiabatic process. Okay, remember. So before doing the derivation, first you should have the idea of adiabatic process. It is a process where no heat transfer takes place between system and surroundings. Okay, and the equation for adiabatic process is what I say, PV raised to gamma equals to constant. You remember, it's a standard equation for adiabatic process. T into V to the power of gamma equals to constant, where gamma is ratio of specific heats. We are having two specific heats, that is Cp by Cv. Gamma equals to Cp by Cv. And what is Cp and Cv? Cp is specific heat at constant pressure. The amount of heat required to raise unit mass of the substance through unit degree rise in the temperature. That is the definition of Cp. And the value of Cp, you should remember, 1.005 kilojoules per kg Kelvin. One more specific heat, that is at constant volume and represented by symbol C suffix V, Cv. And it is defined as the amount of heat required to raise unit mass of the substance to unit degree rise in temperature at a constant volume. That is a specific heat at constant volume. And the value of Cv in SI unit is 0.718 kilojoules per kg Kelvin. You have to remember these two values, because in some of the numerical problems, you have to, they won't give the values. You have to remember these two values, 1 is Cp equals to 1.005 kilojoules per kg Kelvin, and another one is Cv equals to 0.718 kilojoules per kg Kelvin. Suppose you take the ratio 1.005 divided by 0.718, you get exactly 1.4. The value of gamma for air is 1.4. Air is a standard gas, okay? And water is a standard liquid, you remember. So gamma is 1.4 for air. Adiabatic process is one in which there is no heat transfer between system and surroundings. Follow the law, PV raised to gamma equals to constant, where Cp equals to 1.005, Cv is 0.718, and gamma is 1.4. Okay, next step is you have to draw the PV diagram. As I said, isothermal process, adiabatic process, and polytropic process has the same nature of curve, but only difference in the equation. Isothermal is PV equals to constant, adiabatic is PV raised to gamma equals to constant, and polytropic is PV raised to n equals to constant. So these things you should remember. So once you write the equation, you have to draw the PV diagram. PV diagram is parabolic curve between the state points 1 to 2, and you have to write the equation as PV raised to gamma equals to constant. So after writing PV diagram only, you have to start the derivation. Now, a first step, as I said, you have to write the PdV work or displacement work. So W1 to 2 is integration of PdV. So we know that for polytropic process, PV raised to gamma equals to P1 V1 to the power of gamma equals to P2 V to the power of gamma equals to constant. So PV raised to gamma equals to constant, it is a standard equation. Suppose you take the process between the two state points 1 and 2, you have to rewrite the equation as P1 V1 to the power of gamma equals to P2 V to the power of gamma equals to constant. Whenever the process...
Sir.
Tell me.
Excuse me. Sir, but for polytropic, it is PV to the power N.
Correct. Okay.
But here it is gamma, sir.
Gamma. In adiabatic, you have to take index as gamma. Okay, it is a Greek word. Gamma you have to take. And derivation is same. In adiabatic process, you have to take gamma, and in polytropic, instead of gamma, you have to take n. Okay. Understood or not? Okay. In adiabatic process, equation is PV raised to gamma equals to constant, and in polytropic process, the equation is PV raised to n equals to constant. Then what is the difference between gamma and n is that gamma is always Cp by Cv, but n is just an index. It may be 1.2 or it may be 1.3 or 1.5, like that, according to the type of gas used in the system. But gamma is always standard value. It is always 1.4 for air, but the value of n varies, you remember. That is the difference between gamma and n. And in adiabatic process, there will be heat transfer. But in polytropics, there will be heat transfer. That is the difference between adiabatic and polytropic. They're exactly same. Whatever derivation you are doing is exactly same for that as that of polytropic process. But instead of gamma, you have to take as n. Okay. You remember. Now, I'll start the derivation. Okay. W1 to 2 is integration of C divided by V to the power of gamma dV. Okay. Now, you can write, so you say PV raised to gamma equals to constant, so we have to find out P. What is P? C divided by V to the power of gamma. Now, we have to substitute the value of P as V to the power of gamma in equation number 1. Okay, so P is nothing but what? C divided by V to the power of gamma dV. Okay. Now, you see, I am taking this as a denominator, you have to take in the numerator. It is nothing but integration of C into V to the power of minus gamma into dV. So, here V to the power of plus gamma, when you are taking in numerator term, you have to write it as V to the power of minus gamma, and you have to write dV as it is. How we are getting C divided by V to the power of gamma is nothing but, so PV raised to gamma equals to constant. So, P equals to C divided by V to the power of gamma. Okay. And here in this next step, I am taking the V to the power of gamma, which is in denominator term, I am taking in numerator term. Okay. already we know integration of v to the, anyhow c is constant, you have to take constant outside and just you have to integrate integration of minus v to the power of minus comma into dv between the limits 1 to 2. Okay, you know integration of x to the power of minus 1 dx is nothing but x to the power of minus x plus 1 divided by minus x plus 1. Same thing here. So integration of v to the power of minus comma into dv is nothing but v to the power of minus comma plus 1 divided by minus comma plus 1 within the limits 1 to 2. Okay, now we have to put the limits, that is 1 to 2. Okay, this is general equation. Next, c you put as it is. And here, when you substitute to the upper and lower limits, we can write v2 to the power of minus gamma plus 1 minus of v1, lower limit v1 to the power of minus gamma plus 1 divided by this denominator, minus gamma plus 1. Okay. Now, next step, you have to simplify the equation. Okay. First, you write c into v to the power of minus gamma plus 1 minus c into v1 to the power of minus gamma plus 1, and denominator is minus gamma plus 1. Okay, so first you have to substitute the limits and then you have to simplify the equation. C into v to the power of minus gamma plus 1 minus c into v1 to the power of minus gamma plus 1 divided by minus gamma plus 1. Next step is most important. Okay, next you have to once again simplify. You can rewrite the equation as c into v to the power of minus gamma plus 1 divided by minus gamma plus 1 minus of c into v1 to the power of minus gamma plus 1 divided by minus gamma plus 1. Okay, here you should be very careful because here we are having v2 term and here we are having v1 term. For c, what is c? C is nothing but you have to take p2v to the power of gamma in this equation. Don't take p1v1. Suppose you are taking p1v1, you will get the wrong derivation. So here, because a second term, we are having v2. So where is c? C is nothing but p2v to the power of gamma. You have to substitute here. Okay. So in place of c, we have to substitute the value of c as p2v to the power of gamma because second term is v2. Remember, it's the most important step. Okay, p2 v to the power of gamma into v to the power of minus gamma plus 1 and divided by minus gamma plus 1, you put as it is. And second term you take here, where second term is v1 is there. Okay, so which value of c you are going to take? P1 v1 to the power of gamma. Here, don't take p2 v2 because second term is our v1. So c is nothing but p1 v1 to the power of gamma. We have to take the value of c as p1 v1 to the power of gamma into v1 to the power of minus gamma plus 1 divided by minus gamma plus 1. Okay. Now you take the LCM and simplify the equation. Okay. So, and you have to apply the law of index. That is x to the power of a into x to the power of b is nothing but x to the power of a plus b. Same principle you follow here. So p2 v2, because we're having 2 v2 and you have to sum up the index. Okay, v2 into x into v2 into y is nothing but v2 to the power of x plus y. Same thing you have to apply. You put v2 as it is and you have to add the index terms. Okay, gamma minus gamma plus 1 and minus p1 you put as it is, v1 you put as it is, and just you have to sum up the index term. Gamma minus gamma plus 1. Gamma gets cancelled. So what will you get? P2 V2 and to the power of 1. Okay, don't write to the power of 1 because gamma gets cancelled. Here in the second term also, gamma gets cancelled. We'll get P1 V1 divided by 1 minus gamma. Okay. Next term. So first here P2 V2. Now I want to write the equation. First, I want to write it as P1 V1. What you are going to do? You are going to multiply the entire equation by minus term. Okay. So this is the equation. But first, I want to write P1 V1. So you can rewrite the equation as P1 V1. You have to multiply the entire equation by minus. What will you get? P1 V1 minus P2 V2. Here, instead of 1 minus gamma, just you have to write gamma minus 1 because we are going to multiply the entire equation by minus 1. So this is the standard equation for the work done during adiabatic process. Are you followed all the steps? Okay, any doubts in the steps? Guys, you have to write all the steps one by one, okay? In the derivation, don't write the final answer directly, okay? You will get the less mark, okay? Whenever derivation is asked, you are going to write all the steps one by one, okay? What I explained, first you have to write the PDV work, next you have to write whatever the equation for adiabatic process, next you have to find out P, you have to substitute the value of P in the given equation, then you have to take the integration, so you have to apply the law of index, then finally we are getting the equation as P1V1 minus P2V2 divided by gamma minus 1. Okay. Now, this is whatever equation number 3 is the equation for displacement work for adiabatic process in terms of pressure and volume and also gamma. You remember the value of gamma is Cp by Cv. Okay. Now, next step is okay. So we know that P1 V1 equals to MRT1 and P2 V2 equals to MRT2. Next step is you can substitute the value of P1 V1 as MRT1 minus P2 V2 as MRT2. You just apply the ideal gas equation, that is MRT1 minus MRT2 divided by gamma minus 1. And here you got to take MR as common. And in the bracket, you'll get T2 minus T1 divided by 1 minus gamma, MR into T1 minus T2 divided by gamma minus 1. Okay. So better you write the second equation only. So don't remember this equation. Better you write P1 V1 minus P2 V2 divided by gamma minus 1. So whatever equation it gives in terms of pressure, volume, and gamma. Suppose if you are going to express in terms of MR, MR T1 minus MR T2 divided by gamma minus 1. You have to take MR as common in the bracket, T1 minus T2 divided by gamma minus 1. Okay. Suppose I am going to take M, that is mass of the gas as 1 kg. In that case, you take it as 1 kg. So what you get? R into T2 minus T1 divided by 1 minus gamma. So whatever equation I derived is the most important derivation, because the same equation you are having in the fifth module also. That's why I try to understand this derivation properly. So whatever equations we are learning in second module, same equation, no change at all in the module 5. That's why this is one of the important chapter in thermodynamics. Okay. So you remember the work done during adiabatic process, P1 V1 minus P2 V2 divided by gamma minus 1, or MR into T1 minus T2 divided by gamma minus 1. Okay. This is the expression for adiabatic process. Okay. Now, so the polytropic process is exactly same. Okay, I am telling you. So whatever equation you are having, the same equation you have to take, just you have to replace the gamma by N. Okay. So try to do derivation yourself. Okay. I'll give the assignment. Okay. So all of you have to do the assignment. I'll post in the Google Classroom so that this assignment is nothing but, so you have to draw the PV diagram of all the 5 process, and you have to find out the work done during all the 5 process. Hope you understood the derivation. Polytropic process is exactly same, no change at all, I'm telling you. So whatever equation we derived, the same steps you have to follow, but only the thing is, instead of gamma, you have to take the symbol as N. Okay, and just you remember, polytropic process is different and adiabatic process is different. Gamma is, it is always ratio of Cp by Cv. On the other hand, N is just an index. Okay, so try to do the displacement work done during polytropic process by yourself. Okay, and whatever steps we followed, so just you change the symbol. Then final equation is nothing but, in polytropic process, P1 V1 minus P2 V2 divided by N minus 1. Okay. So just you remember, that is a standard equation for the work done during polytropic process, or in terms of MRT, MR into T1 minus T2 divided by N minus 1. So these are the five important thermodynamic process with derivations. Okay. Okay. Next, I'll explain one more concept that is called as the heat concept. As I said, so the thermodynamics mainly deals with the work and the heat. We studied the work concept. Okay, the work is nothing but the product of force and displacement. Okay. On the other hand, heat is another form of the energy. Okay. Then how we are going to define the heat? Okay, heat is a form of energy that is transferred from one system to another system due to temperature difference. So whenever temperature difference is there, then only we'll get the heat transfer. Okay, and you remember the heat always flows from higher temperature gradient to lower temperature gradient, and it cannot flow from lower temperature to higher temperature. This concept we are going to study in third module, that is second law of thermodynamics we'll study. Remember, the heat is a form of the energy. It occurs due to virtue of temperature difference between two systems. And unit of joule is SI unit. Joule in case of SI unit. Okay. Joule is nothing but Newton meter. Okay. Next, sign convention. We studied sign convention for work done. What is sign convention for work done? So whenever work is done on the system, it is
negative,
positive. Okay, I explained in the previous class. Whenever work done by system, it is taken as positive, and work is done on the system is negative. Remember, whenever work is done on the system is negative, work done by the system is positive. But whenever we come to the heat concept, it is reverse. Okay, whenever heat added to the system is positive, and whenever the heat taken from the system is negative. Remember, exactly opposite to that of our work done on the system is negative, work done by the system is positive. On the other hand, heat transferred to the system is positive, and the heat is removed from the system is negative. And one more is that adiabatic flow already we studied, there is no heat transfer at all. Okay, so this is the heat concept, and it is exactly similar to our work done, that is it is also path function. Okay, next I will discuss the modes of heat transfer. So there are three modes of heat transfer. Okay, one is conduction, and one is convection, and another one is radiation. Okay, these are three modes of heat transfer. First one is conduction. Okay, already we know conduction is an important process. Here it is a movement of or transfer of the heat from one object to another object that has a different temperature when they are a direct contact with each other. For example, we can warm our hands by touching hot water bottles. Okay, there will be directly a thermal conduction takes place. Whenever you boil the water, or whenever you heat a metallic rod, in that case the temperature heat transfer takes place from one part to another part. This is the thermal conduction. Okay, whenever we are having direct contact of the bodies, in that case thermal conduction takes place. Okay. Next, convection. Convective heat transfer, it is a transfer of the heat. Okay, we are having so many examples of thermal conduction. Okay, that is the heating of the coil. Then we are having so many examples of thermal conduction. Convective heat transfer, it is mainly takes place between the two medium. Okay, the transfer of the heat from one medium to another medium. For example, suppose you are taking certain quantity of the water in a vessel. Suppose you boil it, then there is a transfer of the heat from the surface of the water to the surroundings. That is, the transfer of the heat takes place between two medium. Okay, that is the convection, the transfer of the heat from one medium to another medium. Okay, and another example is the blowing of the hot air over the building is also another example of convection. Okay, and you are going to study the convection in heat transfer that is in sixth semester. That is, one is natural convection and forced convection. Okay, the convection is a mode of heat transfer which occurs in a different fluid media. Okay, and natural convection means it occurs naturally. And in case of forced convection, so we have to use some external means to increase the rate of heat transfer. For example, fan or blower is used to increase the rate of the heat transfer. Suppose you use fan, the rate of heat transfer will be more as compared to natural convection. Okay. Examples: boiling of the water, the heat passes from burner to the point. Okay, steaming cup of hot tea, ice melting. These are the example of convective heat transfer. Okay, and third mode of heat transfer is thermal radiation. Okay, it is a process by which the energy which is in the form of electromagnetic waves is emitted by heated surface in all directions and travels directly to its point of absorption. For example, whatever the rays we are getting from the sun is the best example of thermal radiation. Okay, the good example. Okay, so without affecting the medium. Okay, media is not required here, so that whatever the energy we are receiving, which is in the form of electromagnetic waves. Okay, so these are the three modes of the heat transfer. One is thermal conduction. So whenever we are having the two bodies in direct contact or within the body itself, there is a flow of heat from one part to another part, or from one point to another point. That is a thermal conduction. Second one is convection, convective heat transfer. The heat transfer takes place between the two different media. Okay, for example, the transfer of the heat from the surface of the water to the surroundings, or the blow of hot air over the buildings. And third one is the thermal radiation, which is does not require any medium. Okay, so that we have whatever the energy we are receiving, which is in the form of electromagnetic waves. Okay, so these are the three modes of heat transfer. You should remember what is the heat, the sign convention of heat, okay, and then the example of the heat transfer. Okay, in the next class we'll discuss the differences between the work transfer and the heat transfer. Okay, I'll stop sharing. Okay. Understood, guys? Any doubts in the derivation or concept? Do you have any doubts? So this is one of the important chapter in thermodynamics. You have to understand all the concepts properly. Okay, that's why I repeated the derivation. Okay, so today I'll give some assignments. All of you have to do the assignment. Assignment is nothing but, so you have to derive the expression for work done for all the five processes, including the PV diagrams. Okay, what you can do, just you take the papers and just write down your USN and name, and then so you have to derive the work done for all the five processes. Okay, so I'll stop the session now. Okay, those who have not entered your USN, please enter your USN in the chat box. Okay, then only your attendance will be considered. Okay, otherwise it is very difficult to consider the attendance. So those who have not entered, you have to enter your attendance in the chat box. Okay, thank you one and all for joining. I'll stop the session now.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.